Hello, everyone, and welcome to the CyberWire's Research Saturday, presented by the Hewlett Foundation's Cyber Initiative. I'm Dave Bittner, and this is our weekly conversation with researchers and analysts tracking down threats and vulnerabilities and solving some of the hard problems of protecting ourselves in a rapidly evolving cyberspace. Thanks for joining us. And now, a moment to tell you about our sponsor, the Hewlett Foundation's Cyber Initiative. While government and industry focus on the latest cyber threats, we still need more institutions and individuals who take a longer view. They're the people who are helping to create the norms and policies that will keep us all safe in cyberspace. The Cyber Initiative supports a cyber policy field that offers thoughtful solutions to complex challenges for the benefit of societies around the world. Learn more at hewlett.org/cyber.
2 years ago, the Electronic Frontier Foundation presented at Black Hat about an operation that they called Operation Manual.
That's Mike Murray. He's the VP of Security Intelligence at Lookout. Today, he's discussing research from Lookout and the EFF about the recent discovery of Dark Caracal, a mobile advanced persistent threat actor conducting a global espionage campaign.
Operation Manual, at the time, was believed to be the Kazakhstan government, and we still believe it was the Kazakhstan government, but at the time, it was the Kazakhstan government working with a lower-end cybersecurity actor. And so one of our leaders on my team was reading the report, and the report mentioned that they believed that there was an Android component, a mobile malware component, to the attacks, but that they didn't have any evidence of it. And Lookout has a huge data set around what is mobile. We have over 50 million apps in our app database. So he looked at it and thought, well, if there's anyone who's going to find the Android component, it's us. And he went looking and found it. And what we originally started out with was a blog entry that simply just stated, hey, we went and found the mobile component of this. Here's the mobile component. And we reached out to EFF, and we all agreed that we would work together to put out a couple of blog entries and just say, hey, look, we found this. And as we started to investigate, things stopped making sense. So, you know, you had this report that was all about Kazakhstan and about this actor in India that was doing this work. And the information that we started to see started to be inconsistent with the narrative that we thought we were looking at. And we were in some ways very lucky because the attacker had made some errors that left some significant parts of their infrastructure with information public that they probably didn't want to see or didn't want us to see. We found, for example, they had left the logs of everyone who's connecting to the server and connecting to the system either compromised, people's devices who were uploading data to the server, as well as the administrative logins, who was actually logging into the system. And we started to look at it, and it had nothing to do with Kazakhstan. And so we started to pull on the threads, as one does in an investigation. And more, it started to point to a much more globally active actor, and an actor who was doing very nation-state level things across a much wider swath than just what had originally been reported. And at a point in the investigation, we got a lead on an email address that was used in many other campaigns. The email address is referred to in our report, and we shorthanded the email address to Op13. But Op13 turned out that people had been seeing Op13 over the years, many, many years. It had been attributed to potentially looking like the Russians. It had been attributed to various other actors. And we started to really pull on the threads to figure out what was behind this, and eventually realized that all of the connections from the server and all of the information, and ultimately we were lucky again in that some of the data on the server appeared to be the attackers testing their own software. And when they were testing it, it very clearly went back to this one building in Beirut. And so suddenly nobody ever thought of Beirut and Lebanon as having any sort of cyber capability. So that was a huge surprise. And we obviously chased it down further and eventually wrote this massive report, sort of detailing all of the activity that they were doing globally and what we were seeing and what information was available on the infrastructure that we had access to, and the information about infrastructure that we didn't have access to or we knew about, and really just put all the pieces together. But it took many, many months. And this happened, the original activity of going and finding the pieces of Android malware that the EFF had alluded to happened in May, and obviously you didn't see our report until February. There was a lot of pieces to this.
Well, let's pull some more of those threads. I mean, take us through it. You get the revelation that that things are happening in Beirut, and you, I suppose, want to sort of nail down that piece of information, verify, make sure that what you suspect is actually so. Take it from there. What happens next?
I'll take it from the inside for a second. Mm. First of all, a lot of conversations about, really? Beirut? Lebanon? That can't be possible. And so because of our own doubt, because we all really had a whole lot of doubt about this, we spent a lot of time fact-checking and trying to understand what we were seeing. And even to the point that we were lucky that some people that were related to us had been visiting Beirut, and we actually had them check out certain wireless networks. So let me back up for a second.
Yeah.
One of the big keys to understanding what the building was in those test devices, what we believed to be test devices. And the way we figured out that they were test devices is, for example, imagine you're a malware author testing your malware. You're not going to test it on your own phone. You're going to test it on some burner phone that has three contacts and four fake emails in it, and you're going to see if you can steal that. Well, that doesn't look like anyone's real phone, right? Mm-hmm. And we found a bunch of things that looked like that. And all of these phones were connected to this one wireless network. Mm-hmm. And so we started out by doing open source intelligence on there are various sites that you can say, you know, show me the places that this wireless network exists in the world. And we have screenshots of that in the report where the open source intelligence says this wireless network is. And then, like I said, we lucked out in that some people were sort of transiting the country that were friends of ours and said, hey, can you just like walk by this and see if you see this wireless network for real? And obviously the wireless network was there. Mm-hmm. And it turned out that there was no way that wireless network was not in this one building. And the building literally says on the top of the building that it belongs to the Lebanese General Security Directorate, basically the GDGS is the acronym. I don't remember what it exactly stands for, but that is basically the Lebanese version of sort of in U.S. terms, it would be like the FBI, the CIA, and Customs all in one building. These guys do border patrol and all these things. Now, we cannot attribute, and we were very careful in our attribution because we don't know who inside that building is doing this. This might be freelancers who just happen to work for the government. They might have leased office space. We don't know exactly who the people are. And so we're being very careful in what we say because we can't prove it was actually the Lebanese government. We're 100% sure that the people who are doing this were in that building. So, you know, draw further conclusions as you will.
So, I mean, take us from there. You determine that that's where things are going on and you're taking a closer look at this. So what exactly does this software set out to do?
The software sets out to steal people's information. And so let me back up for a second, just on a more philosophical point. Hmm. 5 years ago, you would have seen groups like this dabble in cyber espionage because breaking into a bunch of people's desktops, you can steal information, but it's not really a great espionage tool. If I want to chase bad guys, say I want to do, I'm going to pick the nice case. I'm going to pick the case that everybody's happy with. Say I want to do counterterrorism, right? And I want to track down terrorists. Breaking into their laptops, it tells me a little bit about their operations, and I can probably read their email, et cetera, et cetera. Breaking into their phones when the phone has a extremely accurate camera, an extremely accurate microphone, a GPS that can geolocate you anywhere in the world. Breaking into phones gives you such a rich picture of people's lives. that seeing these folks break into thousands of phones globally and steal information, you know, sort of indiscriminately. And I have to say, we don't know what they did with that information. You know, that's far outside my or any of my team's pay grade. Our job is to figure out, you know, that the attackers are doing it and work to protect the industry and protect our customers and protect the people around us from this kind of malicious behavior. But seeing that kind of widespread espionage activity where you have, you know, information about exactly where your targets are at any given time, you know, the nation states have largely moved to this capability. I don't know of any major nation state at this point who doesn't have a capability for this purpose, right? If I am any sort of well-meaning government, if I want to track down drug traffickers or terrorists, etc., this capability is fantastic as long as it's used appropriately. Now, of course, what we also see is it being used illicitly. I'm sure that some of the people who were attacked by this were used in appropriate ways, but we've seen around the world, and not specifically in Dark Caracal, because we didn't dig too deeply into who the victims were. Again, beyond our pay grade, and frankly, there was just so much information; it was really hard to do. We had over 500,000 text messages. It's really hard to have people on my team sit and try and read through 500,000 text messages, especially given the region of the world, how many of them were in Arabic or other languages or even dialects of Arabic that the people don't understand over here, right? We weren't going to analyze who the targets were, but the point being, these targets were compromised in a level that they could be followed around. Their phone calls could be recorded and were recorded. You know, all of their personal information was stolen. Their pictures were stolen. Like, this is an incredibly deep compromise of these people's lives. And because of that, you start to see a real shift where 5 years ago, if you were going to have this capability, you had to be a top level nation state. Now you see even the minor nation states moving towards this capability because it's so valuable to you from an espionage perspective.
Now, are they getting these components off the shelf? Are they custom developing? What's the spread, your analysis of the software? What are you seeing here?
Little of both. So what we really saw was a lot of these tools are variants of things that have been out in the world. Malware on the desktop, for example, one of the pieces of malware that they seem to use a lot is known as Banduke. Banduke's been available on the black market for a long time. What was particularly interesting about what we saw with their use of Banduke was the version of Banduke that they had didn't correspond to the version that's available publicly. They had the super premium upgrade, so to speak, with functionality that didn't exist in the one that you could go buy on the dark web. The Android malware, however, seems to be largely custom developed. We hadn't seen it before in that exact form. I mean, I think there's no malware author in the world that doesn't, or no software developer in the world that doesn't borrow code from places, right?
Sure.
I've never met a software developer who didn't go to Stack Overflow at some point and cut and paste a piece of code.
Yeah.
So that stuff exists. And so, you know, not exactly off the shelf, but traditionally sort of the way that everybody else does it. But that malware was relatively unique, as was the other piece of what we believe to be in early development malware that we called CrossRat. It appears to be almost, in fact, the version number on the first version of CrossRat we got was 0.1. We saw that as sort of next generation capabilities that they're just evolving into. It looks like they're trying to get away from the traditional Banduke malware because so many vendors know what it is.
Yeah, before we dig into some of the details of CrossRat, can you give us an idea of the breadth of operating systems that they're able to hit?
Yeah, so we saw pretty much everything on the desktop, so Windows, Linux, Mac OS. We also saw Android. Now, what's interesting, people always ask me, well, what about iOS? And I think iOS is largely an issue of demographics for them. And so if you think about the region of the world that they're operating in and what many of their targets would be, Lebanon, for internal purposes, as well as neighboring Syria, Iraq, et cetera, those aren't places where people are buying a $1,000 iPhone X very often, right? And so if I'm an attacker, I always explain attackers to people in terms of security software, or in terms of just normal software business. If you're a software developer and you know 95% of your customers are running Android, why would you spend all the time to build an iOS version? And so I think if you were to see that region become extremely, you know, heavy in iOS, you'd see them evolve an iOS capability. But what we saw was so prolific. You know, if you're getting all the information on most of your targets, why would you invest in building another version?
Take me through the timeline here, because one of the things that struck me about your research is how far back this campaign goes.
Absolutely. And this is why, this is actually why we named it Caracal. The EFF folks love cats, and so do we. So so like Manuel is a type of cat. A caracal is also a type of cat. But one of the things when we were looking into names was that the caracal it's a cat that has often been seen and been mistaken for other types of cats. And that's what we saw here, is that these folks have been active for quite a long time. The infrastructure has been up for many years. There have been attacks reported against that infrastructure for many years. Even the manual work was 2 years ago, right? And even with that manual work, where it was attributed to somebody else, we saw that people knew that this was happening, but they didn't understand the context of what they were looking at. And that was, to me, the most fascinating thing, is you could have an attacker that's this prolific, you know, doing politically motivated work, attacking targets globally, you know, whether for Kazakhstan or for their own purposes or for, you know, for other targets. And these attacks are happening for years and years. And even the best minds in security are looking at it and thinking it's something else. It was very much a hiding in plain sight strategy. And I think part of that, we even fell victim to this in our discussions, the idea that it could be coming out of Lebanon was sort of an easy thing to write off. You know, if I asked you about cyber powers like 2 months ago, Lebanon would be a long way down your list of people. Even if I said it's a Middle Eastern actor, you would probably say Israel, Iran, Saudi Arabia. You know, you'd go down a long way on that list before you got to Lebanon.
Well, to that point, do you think that this indicates that Lebanon upped their game, and or does it mean that there's more activity going on from some of these, what we would previously have described as lesser actors? Do you follow my
Yes.
line of questioning there?
Completely. And actually that to me, so people ask me what the real interesting point to this is, and there's so many little angles to this story. But for me, especially when I talk to our enterprise customers, when I talk to, you know, CISOs of big banks or you know, anybody who's working globally, the most interesting thing to me is that it's no longer a game where APT only comes from China, North Korea, the Five Eyes, and Russia. APT is becoming the provenance, because just like the internet has democratized so many other things, right? You know, I'm old enough to remember 20 years ago when building a website required a special set of skills. Now it requires I pop up WordPress or I go to Squarespace and suddenly I have a website in 10 minutes. The same thing's happening for the bad guys. Same thing's happening in the cyber attacker world. 10 years ago, to have this kind of capability, you had to put in, you know, millions, tens of millions, hundreds of millions of dollars like those large countries. Now you can do it with a handful of computer science grads and a lot of cutting and pasting off of Stack Overflow and you know, pulling in open source tools. What this really says is the landscape of attackers who can perform this level of espionage is in the middle of exploding, and especially because mobile is so useful. You know, if you think about the mobile platform as, like, if I really wanted to compromise your life and follow you around, there's no better way than to track your cell phone.
Sure.
Right? I can literally listen to you at all times. You probably, like, you go into every meeting, you might close your laptop in a meeting, but you very rarely turn your cell phone off in a meeting. You know, so the opportunity for these nation states who want to use this capability is expanding at the same time that it's becoming easier and more scalable to implement.
Now, take us through the patterns of attacks here. How do people get infected, and how targeted were the attacks?
Incredibly. So the way that, across the board, the mobile kill chain, whereas on the traditional desktop, there's a million ways to get infected, right? You could go to the wrong website, you get phished, you know, someone attacks you directly, whether attacking your website, et cetera. The mobile kill chain almost always looks the same. And that it starts with some sort of phishing message. We've seen a proliferation of text and other messaging-based phishing that leads the victim to click on a link or go to a site, which does one of two things. Just asks them to install an app, which is what Dark Caracal did. They literally had a page that was called Secure Android and had Trojaned versions of all the communications apps you could think of, you know. And so you would get a message from me generally through Facebook. These guys use Facebook a lot. Generally through Facebook, you'd get a message from me that said, hey, I just got an update to my WhatsApp that has extra security in it. Go to this site, grab it, and then we can talk extra secure, right? And we can talk more securely. Of course, you would download that app, install it on your device, and then I would have complete control of your device while you talk to me on WhatsApp.
But to me, it still functions as WhatsApp. It's just been Trojanized.
You bet it does.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's WhatsApp with a little bit of extra, and the extra is what you really don't want.
Right.
So what's interesting is it wasn't technically sophisticated. It relied on just simply people trusting the people that are sending the messages and falling for it the way that so many other phishing type attacks were.
But again, in terms of them targeting people, does it seem like, were they taking more of a shotgun approach, or did they know who they wanted?
So we're not sure. And,
yeah.
and we, the, that's the hardest thing. Like I've said it to many people. Understanding that kind of stuff is really above our pay grade.
Mm.
And obviously we shared information with the appropriate authorities in various countries to make sure that people were remediating and people were being protected. But ultimately, we try to keep out of the attribution game. It's my team and pretty much any security research team is not tooled to understand the nuances of who everyone in Lebanon is and whether they're politically relevant and why they were targeted. That's really a job for law enforcement agencies and the like. And so we tried to stay away. We certainly saw what appeared to be patterns in the data, but again, didn't dig in because our focus was really on what does the software do? How is it getting on devices? And how can we stop that? And how can we inform the rest of the community on how to stop that as well? That to me is our primary mission. There are people in the world whose job attribution is, and they're way better at it than we will ever be. I see a lot of security firms try and get into attribution, and so often it's wrong.
So let's talk about prevention and mitigation. If someone found themselves infected by this, would antivirus discover it?
Absolutely. So especially now, right? It wouldn't have, most products wouldn't have when it first came out, obviously, because they didn't know it existed. But these days, since we released the report, we believe that pretty much, whether the CrossRouter Banduke samples or the Palace samples, which is the mobile malware, you know, our customers have been protected against that for many, many months. The interesting thing is you have to be in a place and a mindset where you know to install that software. And I think a lot of the times targets of this kind of stuff, especially, you know, dissidents, reporters, political figures, et cetera, they're not generally the most tech savvy people. So making sure that they have the right controls on their devices is really, it's really paramount, but it's a message that we all have to get out.
Is there a false sense of security on the mobile side?
Oh yeah, is there ever? We've all fallen into the belief. I think it's two pieces. First, we've fallen into the belief that because it's Apple and Google and they're such huge companies, that they'll protect us. Now, I'm old enough to remember a time when people believed the same thing about Microsoft in the 90s, right?
And Mike, nobody ever believed that about Microsoft.
No, you're absolutely not. When NT4 came out, people said, oh, this is the most secure operating system. We can run our business on it.
Right, right.
In, say, 1997, there was that belief.
No, you're absolutely right. I'm kidding, but you are absolutely correct.
Man, we got disabused of that notion fast, didn't we?
We did.
But what's amazing is we all believe the same thing about Apple, and especially Apple. Apple's done a really great job of making people believe this, but also Android. And so there's that part. I think there's another part to it. I think so many of us established our relationship with the technology that is a cell phone when it was basically, depending on how old you are, it was a brick that you had to carry around, or it was like a Motorola Razr flip phone. And the idea that that could be compromised to compromise your life was kind of, it was so far out there that nobody believed it. And I think a lot of people still believe that their mobile device is simply nothing more than a thing that they get phone calls on and take text messages on. And yet the mobile device has now taken this central role in our digital world, even up to and including that for almost everybody I know, the two-factor token for all of their enterprise access is now on that device. And so we've put ourselves in this world where we think of it as a Motorola Razr flip phone, but it literally has the keys to everything and has the computing power of a Cray 3 supercomputer. And that's an actually specific benchmark. The iPhone 7 is actually the equivalent of the Cray 3 supercomputer.
Wow.
In terms of processing power and memory access. Whenever I tell somebody that, they're shocked by it, which you really shouldn't be. And then the idea that you would take that level of computing power, if I told you I was going to give you a supercomputer, but I was never going to secure it, I wasn't going to do anything to secure it, you'd be like, you're insane. And yet, almost everybody I know does that with their phones.
I think you're right. I think for most people, it doesn't even strike them that, I think particularly on the iOS side, to even think to install any sort of additional protection, because there is the sense that the walled garden of the app store is going to protect you.
Right. And it doesn't work like that. You know, there has never been a computer system that didn't have vulnerabilities that could be exploited. And especially now, especially because of the value to the high-end attacker of compromising that platform, it's so valuable to the attacker that you have to realize that if there's vulnerabilities, there are people exploiting them, and they're exploiting them for gain. And we just have to get our heads around that this thing that we carry around with us isn't a phone. It's a very powerful computer that almost everybody I know spends a lot of time basically connecting that to every part of their life, their social media, their personal email, their work email, two-factor tokens, you know, all of your contacts and calendar. Like, if I have access to your phone, I can tell you everything about you. And that asset needs to be protected. And yet we treat it like it's not that kind of asset. And it's mind-blowing to me.
You know, as an aside, it reminds me of a tweet I saw a couple months ago it was a long-time Apple employee, you know, one of the old timers, and he said that this new iMac Pro that I just bought, he said, has 11 times more RAM in it than the Apple II. And he said, and by Apple II, I mean all 6.5 million Apple IIs that were ever sold combined. Right?
Yes, exactly.
On this one machine, you know. And so I think you're absolutely right that for those of us who've been around for a while, the scale of how things have changed, how things have developed, I think it's beyond our capability to really imagine.
You bet. And you know what? You know what the worst part about what you just said is the people who have been around for that long. I remember 15 years ago when I was a young whippersnapper. 20 years ago, I guess. Yeah. And when the senior executives wouldn't understand something like email. And we would go, wow, that I don't get it. Why do you still have your email printed out for you? That's insane. We're now become all of us who are now C-level executives and the people in charge are making the same mistakes about the mobile platform that we used to deride senior executives for making about websites. And it's literally just the human condition that as we grow, we rely on our knowledge from previous eras. And if the previous era changes, we have to be really conscious about thinking about it. I love doing the Cray 3 supercomputer in a room full of C-level security executives, because you literally can watch. It's fun to watch it from a stage because the lights come on, and people are like, "Oh my goodness!"
Right.
I have an. So we've taken within Lookout to calling it the forgotten platform, right? These people, you know, us, me included. I'm old enough to make the same mistake. These people are spending hundreds of millions of dollars protecting their Windows desktops and $0 protecting their mobile devices. And yet, one of my favorite stats is we've started investigating this with our customers. Oh, for most enterprise customers, if they do a survey of what platform are people logging into Active Directory for, I have yet to find an organization in the last 3 years that is not more than 50% mobile devices, and in some cases it's 80% mobile devices. Hmm. Right? Imagine if you had 80% of the devices in your network you have no visibility into. How do you protect that environment? Right? But because we're still thinking about it the old way, we're blind to it in the same way that the C-level executives in the 90s didn't understand how the web worked.
So let's bring it home in terms of recommendations. You know, your average person, your enterprise security professional, how worried should they be about this, and what steps should they be taking to make sure that they're not hit with it?
How worried should they be about it? Kind of depends.
Yeah.
How worried should they be about it today? Well, if I'm going to pick on some names. These are not Lookout customers. I'm not, you know, talking out of school. But if I have a real nation state attack problem, right? If I'm anybody who has worried about APT in the last 5 years, defense contractors, you know, financials around the world, any multinational, they should be terrified, because the nation state level attackers, the real serious, what we would call APT, have already figured out that A, this device is so useful, right? In terms of getting access to corporate resources because of the two-factor tokens, but also getting access just to the lives of your targets. And, you know, combined with, if I'm attacking your PC environment, I've got to get by firewalls and antivirus and all of this stuff. If I'm attacking your mobile device, you probably have nothing on that device that tells you that you've been compromised. So I'm not only am I blind, but it's the most valuable thing I can attack. If I was a CSO of one of those companies, I'd be freaking out. This would be the first thing I'd worry about. If I am a Midwestern credit union, and I'm picking on just some random thing that doesn't have a nation state attacker level thing, what I'm thinking about is, in the history of security, all exploits commoditize. What is nation state only today, 3 years from now, is going to be a Metasploit module that anyone can use. And so my thought would be, okay, maybe I don't have to worry about this in, you know, February of 2018 or March of 2018, but I probably have to worry about it in February or March of 2019, and I certainly have to worry about it in February or March of 2020. And so I better start planning. Now, if I'm just the average user, then all of the old rules that we had for PCs apply. Don't click on links from people you don't know. Don't install things that people ask you to install either over the internet or just through an email. Like, the security awareness stuff applies, but what we found is really interesting. All of those rules that we had for doing security awareness well on the desktop, every single person has been taught in their corporate security awareness, when you get an email that looks suspicious, hover over a link to see that it's going to where it says it's going to.
Sure.
Guess what? You can't do that on a mobile platform.
Yep.
That doesn't work. So we've taught our users all this stuff about how to protect themselves, and most of it's not applicable to the mobile platform. And what we're seeing is significantly higher rates of bad behavior on the mobile platform. If I send a phishing email to an organization and I get 10% response, I'm going to get 25% response on the mobile device. Because all the things we've taught the users, first of all the things we've taught don't work, but second, the users are thinking, well, it's my phone. It's, you know, it's not really a computer. It doesn't have access to anything without thinking. It's back to that same, I'm still thinking of it as a phone, not as a super powerful computer that has access to everything in my life. You know, I'm not the one to you know, preach the sky is falling, even though I obviously believe that there's some urgency here. But I think you have to really think about what your risk is, because right now, let me back up for a half second and flip this over. When we saw PC malware evolve, right, starting in the 90s, what we saw was the evolution went from small minor annoyance, you know, in 1998, the I love you virus, you know, to massive annoyance, SQL Slammer, Blaster, et cetera, to nation states later. The mobile ecosystem is going backwards, right? You're going nation states and highly resourced attackers first, and then it trickles down to the cybercrime. So if I'm looking at 2020, 2021, 2022, that's when I think you're going to see the mobile platform becomes a real target for everyone. And it's my goal in life to get to 2021 and 2022 and not have every Android and iOS device, whether car, you know, light switch, etc. I don't want all of those things compromised by ransomware 5 years from now. I think it's important to just realize the scope of the problem and assess for yourself where you are in that spectrum of how fast you need to respond to it.
Our thanks to Mike Murray for joining us. You can find the complete report about Dark Caracal on the Lookout website. It's in the blog section. Thanks to the Hewlett Foundation Cyber Initiative for sponsoring our show. You can learn more about them at hewlett.org/cyber. The CyberWire Research Saturday is proudly produced in Maryland out of the startup studios of Data Tribe, where they're co-building the next generation of cybersecurity teams and technology. It's produced by Pratt Street Media. The coordinating producer is Jennifer Iben. Editor is John Petrick. Technical editor is Chris Russell. Executive editor is Peter Kilpie. And I'm Dave Bittner. Thanks for listening.